The Book of Mormon details a curse put upon Lamanites by God because of their wickedness, which made them dark, loathsome, filthy, and utterly unenticing to the righteous white-skinned Nephites. While some racist references to Nephites being white and delightsome have been sanitized in modern printings, the curse of repulsive dark skin remains as a major plot device in the Book of Mormon. Similar racist teachings about the curse of Cain are also woven into the Book of Abraham, which teaches the descendants of Ham were despised because they were black, had no place among the children of Adam, and could not hold the priesthood. While these teachings remain in current printings of canonized LDS scripture, the LDS Church claims to disavow such theories in their essay, Race and the Priesthood. Brigham Young fought to make and keep Utah a slave territory, despite slavery formerly being illegal in the Mexican territory that Utah displaced. He appealed to LDS scripture and doctrine to support his pro-slavery position. At least 100 African slaves were brought to Utah by LDS members, and many Native Americans were purchased from local tribes. Slavery continued in the Utah Territory until abolition was forced upon it by the U.S. government in 1862. At the command of Brigham Young, the Nauvoo Legion slaughtered around 100 members of the Timpanogos tribe, many of whom had never attacked Mormon settlements. Squaw Peak is named after Big Elk's wife, who died in the canyon during the massacre. 7 unarmed Timpanogos were also killed by Mormons at the Battle Creek Massacre for the crime of stealing horses, though no horses had actually been stolen. Brigham Young taught that plural marriage was necessary for salvation. The practice continued for 25 years until the U.S. government formed the Edmunds-Tucker Act in 1887, which threatened seizure of all church assets and temples unless polygamy ceased. While presiding from exile, President John Taylor penned a revelation stating that plural marriage would never be rescinded. 3 years after his death, Wilford Woodruff became prophet. With the government finally ready to enforce the act, Woodruff penned the 1890 Manifesto. This manifesto was presented as the official end of plural marriage, but 250 new plural marriages were secretly performed, including those of LDS apostles. Joseph F. Smith was forced to pen a second manifesto in 1904, this time actually enforcing it in order to appease the government. 2 apostles resigned in protest and were excommunicated. LDS church leaders actively fought against the civil rights movement. The NAACP pressured the LDS church to support civil rights legislation and to reform several LDS policies which discriminated against African Americans, including the priesthood and temple ban. In response, Apostle Ezra Taft Benson called the civil rights movement a communist plot in General Conference. Mark E. Peterson, another apostle, spoke in favor of segregation, suggesting that it was sanctioned by God and ought not be tampered with. Several African American football players from other states' teams refused to play BYU in protest during the late 1960s, and 14 were kicked off the Wyoming team for their stance. In the 1970s, 3 LDS members were excommunicated for criticizing the LDS Church's racial exclusion policies. It wasn't until 1978, and with the possibility of the IRS revoking BYU's tax-exempt status for discrimination, that the church finally reversed its racist policies and allowed black members full church participation. However, interracial dating, and especially interracial marriage, continued to be discouraged by LDS manuals up until 2014. The current prophet, Russell M. Nelson, notably voiced opposition to interracial marriage in 1995, and this council has never been rescinded or disavowed. While some LDS members proudly point to the fact that Utah was early to recognize the right of women to vote, that recognition came with motives that were far from empowering. At the insistence of George Q. Cannon, who believed that women cannot be trusted without someone to guide and influence them, the apostles reorganized the Relief Society, replacing unsuitable women with those who were of the right spirit, and were willing to receive the counsel of their priesthood leaders and husbands. These women, in turn, were to teach the sisters and give them proper views concerning consulting the priesthood. By enforcing obedience to priesthood authority, LDS men multiplied their own political influence by controlling the vote of their wives. Another important movement that the LDS Church actively fought was the Equal Rights Amendment, which stated that civil rights may not be denied on the basis of one's sex. Leaders called meetings and organized at least 9,000 members in the Las Vegas area to distribute literature, make phone calls, and solicit donations. $13,000 were raised by members in California to assist in defeating the movement. Sonia Johnson was excommunicated in December of 1979, for exposing the church's lobbying efforts against the ERA and for criticizing LDS patriarchy. In 2008, the LDS Church once again took a hardline conservative stance in support of Proposition 8, which denied rights for same-sex couples to marry in California. A letter from the First Presidency was read in LDS wards, encouraging church members to do all they could to support the proposed constitutional amendment by donating of their means and time. The LDS Church raised $20 million for ProtectMarriage.com and canvassed more aggressively than any other religious group. Elder Holland claimed that not one red cent of church money went into Prop 8, but it was later revealed that the church spent nearly $200,000 of institutional funds. All of this proved a wasted effort when the proposition was ruled unconstitutional just 2 years later, and gay marriage became legal in all 50 states in 2015. If prophets had any value as divine moral guides, or if they had any prophetic foreknowledge, one could reasonably expect them to introduce positive social changes ahead of their time. As highlighted by the resistance to these and numerous other movements, the LDS Church is consistently decades behind on social issues, consistently lobbies against positive progress, and only does the right thing under heavy outside pressure to do so. While Church Public Relations tries to paint the LDS Church as a global church, the current leadership of the LDS Church are predominantly wealthy, conservative white men from Utah, with an average age of 75. When you imagine the culture these men grew up in, it is no wonder that the church has a chronic problem with dragging its feet on social issues. The power structure of the church also stifles any input or influence from younger generations or persons of non-male gender, with the local bishop or stake president being the only acceptable level of leadership to share concerns with directly. The brethren enjoy access to and influence over top leaders in local Utah government, as well as abroad. A video recording from 2009 was leaked in which an area authority suggested that Senator Gordon Smith and his staff took marching orders from the LDS Church, referring to them as church broke. Senator Smith admitted to voting for the Iraq War in hopes of eventually gaining access for LDS proselyting in the Middle East. In response to leaked bishops' interviews and similar covert recordings, church leaders also tried to implement two-party recording consent laws in Utah, which would require all parties of a conversation to consent to being recorded. The church has also repeatedly lobbied against medicinal marijuana in Utah and has replaced Prop 2 medicinal marijuana legislation against the will of the majority who voted for it. One of the things the LDS Church claims sets it apart from other false faith traditions is a living prophet who continuously receives revelations directly from God. However, prophecies and revelations seem to have virtually dried up in the modern church, and the bar for what may be considered a revelation has dropped drastically. Joseph Smith regularly saw angels and members of the Godhead in vision, and was not shy about declaring God's audibly spoken will to himself and the church. Current leaders are much more bashful, never overtly claiming to have received direct heavenly visitations or audible communication. Future events are rarely, if ever, speculated on, and no major world event has ever successfully been predicted by LDS prophets. The last entry into LDS scripture was the 1978 Official Declaration 2, removing the ban on black members' full church participation. No doctrine or revelation since then has been canonized. The scriptures mention over 20 books of unpublished scripture which remain to be translated or revealed, yet Joseph Smith was the last prophet to produce such translations. In several prominent excommunications, top LDS leadership denied any involvement, stating that church discipline is always a local matter. However, Elder Boyd K. Packer inserted himself into the decision to excommunicate Paul Toscano, and Dehlin H. Oaks was later caught in a lie when attempting to cover up the meeting that had taken place. Dehlin H. Oaks said in an interview that the church doesn't seek apologies and we don't give them, pointing out that the word apology doesn't appear anywhere in the scriptures. Wherever the church has come close to apologizing, their preferred weasel word is regret. In 2007, Elder Henry B. Eyring expressed regret on behalf of church members at a memorial service for the victims of the 1857 Mountain Meadows Massacre. The church also issued a public expression of regret for performing baptisms for the dead on behalf of victims of the Holocaust. These PR statements are empty and meaningless non-apologies. Much like the phrase, "mistakes were made," expressing regret acknowledges the harm done without taking responsibility for it. In the case of the Mountain Meadows statement, the church later insisted that the statement could not be construed as an apology. LDS Church spokesman Mark Tuttle said, "We don't use the word apology, we used profound regret." Neither church leaders nor the institution as a whole has ever taken responsibility for harm done by the LDS Church, and this appears to be intentional institutional policy. Men wield all the power in the church due to their exclusive right to the priesthood. A grown woman must defer to a 12-year-old deacon because he wields the priesthood authority of God, and she doesn't. Women are vastly outnumbered in LDS leadership and only speak for about 10% of the time allotted for general conference. Despite being touted as the world's largest women's organization, the Relief Society is presided over by men. They make no decision or policy without the approval of the brethren. LDS women are discouraged from pursuing any career besides motherhood, while LDS men, as providers, can choose any career path they wish. Young women are taught that it is their duty to prepare for motherhood, and that motherhood will also be their primary purpose in the afterlife. While men are told they will become like God and create worlds in the eternities, women are responsible only for populating those worlds. While male gods can communicate with their mortal children, wives of gods like Heavenly Mother must never be prayed to, and are rarely spoken of. Men can be sealed to multiple women, while women can only be sealed to one man. Up until January of 2019, women were told to hearken to their husbands in the temple, while men only had to hearken to God. Women had to veil their faces when praying in the temple, while men prayed barefaced. Women had to give themselves in marriage, while their husbands received them. Women still have to reveal their secret new name to their husbands, so that their husbands can call them forth in the first resurrection, while men keep their new name a secret. The Church's sexism and homophobia are codified in their legalistic document, The Family, A Proclamation to the World. The document was pieced together from various leaders' previous statements in order to be used in the fight against gay marriage in Hawaii. It was later designated by Apostle Boyd K. Packer as a revelation. It prescribes 1950s ideals for a nuclear family and rigid gender roles, telling women that they are responsible for nurturing their children, while men are responsible for providing, presiding, and protecting. It also makes it clear that only heterosexual marriage is acceptable to God. To this day, it has never been canonized, yet members and church leaders often treat it as incontrovertible scripture. Young women are taught that they are responsible for the lustful thoughts of men and must dress in a way that hides their tempting physique. Women who wear clothing deemed immodest by LDS standards are told that they are walking pornography. Young women are also given extremely unhealthy ideas of virtue, a word often used as a euphemism for virginity. Young women are taught that their virtue can be lost by consensual sex, or even taken from them by rape. They are shown object lessons in which they are compared to chewing gum, which becomes useless and undesirable once chewed, or a cupcake nobody will want if it has been licked, or smashed, or spit on, or any number of similar disgusting analogies. Some are even taught that it is better to die than to lose their virtue. Elizabeth Smart said that these destructive teachings were responsible for making her believe that she no longer had any value after her captor raped her. There have been several deplorable statements made by LDS leaders calling on victims of rape to evaluate their personal responsibility and repent for their part in the act. This reveals their complete ignorance of the concept of consent, their utter lack of empathy for the victim, and the rape culture that is inspired by LDS teachings about modesty, chastity, and virtue. LDS youth, especially the young men, are taught that masturbation is a grave sin. They are taught that lust is committing adultery in their hearts. They are also taught that sexual sin is so evil that only murder is worse. When the dots are connected between these frightful teachings, many LDS youth are imbued with the guilt of a murderer every time they self-abuse or view pornography. These vulnerable youth are required to confess these sins in one-on-one worthiness interviews with their bishops, which is in itself incredibly awkward, embarrassing, and harmful. They are frequently forbidden to take the sacrament until they have had enough follow-up visits to complete their repentance process. This can be humiliating since only unworthy members don't take the sacrament, and everyone can pretty well guess the crimes of a pubescent teen who isn't chewing their morsel of white bread and is always meeting with the bishop. There have been cases where teens have considered or even attempted suicide to escape their guilt and shame. LDS member Kip Eliason killed himself at the age of 16 because he hated himself for having healthy and natural sexual feelings. Along with their unhealthy views on masturbation, the church also teaches that viewing pornography in any form is a vile and harmful sin. Members who have viewed pornography more than once often come to believe that they have a porn addiction, and some even attend remediation classes patterned after Alcoholics Anonymous in order to break their sinful habit. The extreme shame imposed on these porn addicts causes them to relapse repeatedly in a shame feedback loop. Perhaps as a result of these sexually unhealthy teachings and attitudes, Utah is the number one state for paid pornography subscriptions. LDS teachings on homosexuality used to dictate that homosexuality was a choice, or an illness that could be cured with faith and therapy. Out of these uninformed opinions came reparative therapy centers, such as North Star, which attempted to cure homosexual individuals of their deviant desires. This conversion therapy also took place at BYU. Afflicted members were shown gay pornography while being given drugs that induced nausea and vomiting, and had electrical probes strapped to their genitals to measure their arousal. The therapy was unscientific and completely ineffective, and caused a great deal of psychological harm to the many participants. The LDS Church eventually denounced conversion therapy in 2016, although individual members and organizations continue to advertise their conversion services to gay Mormons even today. The LDS Church today officially recognizes that homosexuality is not a choice, though their rhetoric regarding the LGBT community has only been marginally improved. The church gives only two options to queer members who desire companionship and sexual expression: celibacy and solitude for life, or a mixed orientation marriage. These mixed orientation marriages are rarely successful, and more often than not result in divorce. Even things like dating, holding hands, kissing, or cuddling, which are permissible in straight relationships, are forbidden to queer members unless they are done with the opposite sex. In November of 2015, an update to the LDS Handbook of Instructions was leaked. The updated policy dictated that children of homosexual couples are not allowed to be given a name and a blessing, and can't be baptized until they are adults, at which time they must disavow their parents' loving relationship in order to qualify for baptism. This goes completely against the teachings of Christ, who told his disciples to forbid not children from coming to him, who imposed no such restrictions on baptism and salvation, and who made it clear that children ought not suffer for the sins of their parents. In response, thousands of members of the church resigned their membership in the largest LDS mass resignation event in history. Despite massive backlash from members and non-members alike, Russell M. Nelson doubled down and upgraded the policy to a revelation. However, in keeping with LDS tradition, outside pressure eventually forced the church to do the right thing. This revelation was demoted to policy status and was discontinued just 3.5 years after it was implemented. In June of 2017, a 12-year-old girl named Savannah stood in front of her congregation to share her testimony that her heavenly parents made her the way she is, and that they did not make a mistake when they created her as a gay individual. Before she could finish her testimony, the first counselor of her stake presidency cut her microphone and asked her to sit down. While the church pours its funds into PR campaigns and websites claiming to love and welcome their LGBT members, the reality is that the LDS Church only welcomes the silent and celibate members of their community. Utah has consistently higher rates of self-reported lifetime depression than the U.S. rate. Utah also has the highest rate of antidepressant use in the United States. While rates of depression have some correlation with high elevation, as observed in other high-altitude states, these facts still highlight that LDS membership is not at all correlated with higher overall life satisfaction and happiness, and that environmental factors have a greater influence over well-being than religious affiliation. Suicide deaths among Utah youths ages 10 to 17 increased more than 140% between 2011 and 2015, compared with a 23.5% increase nationally in the same age group. Again, while elevation can be blamed for high depression and suicide rates in general, it does not account for suicide rates accelerating, since altitude and other environmental factors have remained constant. There is something unique in Utah and other states with a high LDS population that is causing this increased rate of teen suicide, and the only common factor is the influence of the LDS Church. LDS bishops have no professional training and are not required to pass background checks before being called to that position of trust. Children in the LDS Church frequently meet one-on-one behind closed doors with these bishops. The purpose of these interviews is to determine if the child is worthy for advancements or participation in certain church activities. In order to be considered worthy, children must confess and repent of any sexual misdeeds, including masturbation or viewing pornography. In addition to these interviews being uncomfortable and shameful for these vulnerable children, they also erode important social barriers to what is appropriate to discuss in private with unfamiliar adults. In many instances, this has facilitated grooming, sexual predation, and abuse. While the LDS Church has been made aware of hundreds of cases of ecclesiastical abuse by its bishops, they continue to allow these inappropriate one-on-one sexual interviews with no meaningful improvement to their policies to protect children from abuse. In March of 2018, a recording was leaked of a woman posing as a journalist and interviewing a man named Joseph Bishop. Bishop had held many callings in the LDS Church, including being president of the Missionary Training Center. In the course of the interview, the woman revealed that she had been a sister missionary under his care while they were at the training center in 1984, and confronted him with the accusation that he had groomed and raped her. Bishop claimed he could not remember raping her, despite her accurately describing a room in the basement he had taken her to that had a bed and a TV with blank VHS tapes. He confessed to a career of being a sexual predator starting when he became a bishop in 1972, and admitted to molesting another sister missionary who was at the MTC at the same time, and a possible third victim who he had asked to expose her breasts in the same basement room. While at least two of his victims had made the church aware of his abuses, he continued to be promoted up the ranks and maintained his membership. In response to the leaked recordings, the LDS Church created a dossier designed to discredit the victim, which included her ecclesiastical records and criminal history. The dossier was also sent to Gregory Bishop, son of Joseph Bishop, who eagerly shared it with several news outlets. The church's official statement also made sure to mention that the victim had returned home early from her mission and that she was no longer a member, facts that they used as a dog whistle to active members that she is unfaithful and untrustworthy. These efforts to smear a victim of rape in order to protect the good name of the church show the true character of the men who direct it. Joseph Bishop is still a member of the church in full fellowship. Members aged 18 to 30 are encouraged to attend singles wards. These wards are designed to encourage dating and marriage, and bishops frequently assume the role of matchmaker. Between LDS teachings urging young adults not to delay in getting married, and the high libido of these adults who are not allowed to have sex outside of marriage, many members get married straight out of high school or soon after. A 1992 study found that 45% of LDS women and 23% of LDS men had married by age 19. While that statistic has shifted substantially since then, the pressure to marry young has not gone away, and Mormons on average marry 3 years younger than the national average. These young marriages frequently lead to divorce, while marriages after 25 and before 35 are statistically much more likely to succeed. When the LDS Church gains converts in foreign countries, it tends to also convert them to Western ideals, clothing, and culture, often smothering and supplanting thousands of years of culture in the process. This is especially true of Native American and Polynesian cultures due to the LDS Church teaching that they are directly descended from ancient seafaring Israelites who were given dark skin as a curse for their wickedness. Native American and Polynesian converts are taught to believe that the Book of Mormon is their actual history and heritage, erasing and distorting their true history and culture. The Indian Placement Program was designed for the purpose of assimilating Native American children into white Mormon culture and belief. And the BYU group, Lamanite Generation, now known as Living Legends, appropriated Native culture to encourage LDS belief and Western education among Natives. The Polynesian Cultural Center in Hawaii is also guilty of co-opting and distorting island culture for the purpose of proselyting. Children in Mormonism are taught from a very early age to embrace LDS practices. They are expected to be baptized at 8 years old, despite being too young to understand the weight and consequences of that decision. They sing songs in primary that drill into their minds the importance of following the prophet, paying tithing, attending the temple, going on a mission, eternal families, and sitting still and silent for Jesus. The song Follow the Prophet repeats the phrase over 54 times and borders on brainwashing. Children are also encouraged to bear their testimonies in front of the congregation and their peers, making claims of knowledge that they can't possibly know at such a young age, let alone as an adult. By repeatedly presenting these scripted statements of knowledge and being rewarded by their family and community for their bravery in sharing, it is easy to see how this positive feedback loop creates an illusory truth effect. LDS doctrine teaches that in order to obtain the highest degree of glory in the celestial kingdom and to be with your family in the eternities, you must have a temple marriage with a worthy LDS spouse. If either partner has a faith transition or is no longer temple worthy, the faithful partner is often encouraged by family and church leadership to seek divorce in order to establish a righteous and eternal marriage that ensures celestial glory. An otherwise healthy marriage and loving family can be torn apart here and now by the fear of what might take place in a hypothetical eternal afterlife, where God's supposed justice demands merciless permanent penalties and eternal separation. The church is a secretive organization they call the Strengthening the Church Members Committee, which uses internet surveillance to monitor its members' online activity and sniff out apostasy. If any member posts anything which could harm the good name of the church, this committee sends the offending posts or publications to that member's local leaders so that they can be disciplined. At several prominent excommunications, dossiers have been prepared containing all of the offending publications of the excommunicant. Two church leaders were caught lying about this committee's existence and purpose in the BBC documentary, This World, the Mormon Candidate. While the use of the word shun is absent in LDS teachings, the practice of avoidance and rejection of non-believers that it signifies is encouraged by the Mormon faith. Members are taught to befriend only those who support their LDS beliefs and actively reject anyone who makes them question them. This creates an LDS in-group and a non-member out-group that is seen as less than or even dangerous. Elder D. Todd Christofferson encouraged shunning behavior in his 2014 talk, Saving Your Life. The Word of Wisdom was formed as a health code during a time when common knowledge said that drinking any hot liquids, including soup and hot cocoa, was bad for your health. While most hot liquids are now permissible in the church, certain teas and coffee of any kind are prohibited. This in spite of the evidence that neither drink is harmful and may even provide some health benefits. The health code also allows mild drinks to be made from barley, though the modern church prohibits any alcohol consumption. Meanwhile, sugar, high fructose corn syrup, saturated fats, and other dietary hazards go entirely unmentioned. It would seem that the revelation is in need of a revision to match current LDS practices, as well as the modern scientific understanding of dietary health. In response to attrition caused by increased access to uncorrelated church history, the LDS Church has produced several essays, novels, and websites that attempt to inoculate members against the harsh realities of the past. Rather than providing definitive answers and formal positions on these concerning topics, and instead of apologizing for obvious past wrongs, these works generally muddy the waters, confuse the issues, and provide mealy-mouth excuses for the abhorrent teachings and actions of past church leaders. They also tend to downplay and de-emphasize truth claims that were formerly taught as incontrovertible fact, such as the historicity of the Book of Mormon, Native American identity as Lamanites, Joseph's translation of the literal writings of Abraham, the celestial practice of polygamy, or the human potential for godhood. These disingenuous tactics stand in stark contrast to several church leaders' claims of unprecedented transparency. Church discipline is supposedly designed to save the souls of the transgressors, protect the innocent, and safeguard the purity, integrity, and good name of the church. A court of love is carried out by a panel of men at either the ward or stake level, depending on the sinner's priesthood rank. These men determine if member sins are worthy of disfellowshipment or excommunication through a mock trial that does not allow for a proper defense. Those who have endured these councils rarely feel like their well-being or salvation is the primary concern, and love is certainly not the dominant emotion expressed. Unbeknownst to most members of the church, the LDS endowment and sealing are not the highest ordinances that a member can receive. Certain member couples who tend to be wealthy and in high positions of LDS leadership can be handpicked as candidates for the second anointing. The first part of the second anointing consists of a washing and anointing of the bodies of the participants by an officiator. The second part takes place later in a private ceremony between a married couple, in which the wife symbolically prepares her husband for his death and resurrection, and gives him a priesthood blessing in a private room in the temple. Those who participate in this ordinance are said to have had their calling and election made sure, and their celestial marriage sealed by the Holy Spirit of promise. They also receive the more sure word of prophecy, which means that their exaltation is guaranteed. Any sin committed after the second anointing, short of murder, will not jeopardize their eventual exaltation. Only certain members are afforded this honor based entirely on who they know. Perpetuating such a practice reveals that the church is guilty of clerical cronyism and nepotism, that the LDS God is a respecter of persons, and that upper leadership consider themselves absolved of responsibility for all future sins or mistakes by virtue of a sacred carte blanche. LDS doctrine teaches that members, and especially church leaders, have what they call the spirit of discernment. Essentially, this spiritual gift allows them to perceive the true character and intent of other people. However, LDS prophets and apostles were unable to detect the deception and violent intentions of Mark Hoffman, who sold them hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of forged historical documents before lethally package bombing three LDS antique collectors. Joseph Bishop was personally interviewed by Spencer W. Kimball, Gordon B. Hinckley, Thomas S. Monson, and other apostles, and was found worthy to be called to several high callings in the church, all while being an unrepentant, self-described sexual predator. Ted Bundy was also discerned to be worthy of baptism 3/4 of the way through his career of serial murder. Hundreds of news stories of sexual abuse from bishops, seminary teachers, and even apostles bear witness that this gift of the Spirit is non-existent in the LDS Church. LDS leaders make profits off books and biographies that realistically only sell due to their position in LDS hierarchy. While there is nothing wrong with authoring and selling books, using their position in the church to do so, and selling flowery, flattering biographies of their own lives and achievements, closely resembles the priestcraft described in the Book of Mormon. One of the most brazen attempts to profit from church leadership came when Devin Durant gave his first conference talk and introduced his own invented word, ponderize, a portmanteau of ponder and memorize. When members went looking for the talk and the social media inspired by it, they were surprised to find that a website had been set up in the days leading up to General Conference, and that the site already had merchandise screen printed with the word Ponderize and ready for purchase. Durant's son Ryan had, with his knowledge, set up Ponderize.us in preparation for the hype, and he was ready to turn a profit from his father's conference talk. After a well-deserved public backlash, the merchandise prices first dropped, then profits were promised to be given to the missionary fund, and finally, the site was taken down. The church-owned publishing company Deseret Book, which sells other apostles' repackaged conference talks for royalties, continues to do so with virtually zero criticism. There are numerous stories told by LDS leaders in order to inspire faith, which are demonstrable lies. One recent example was when Jeffrey R. Holland told the story of a hardened biker who was miraculously reconverted to the church by his missionary brother after years of sinful living. The story was shared on several LDS blogs and all across social media. It was so factually false that the actual family in the story had to reach out and correct the falsehood, resulting in an embarrassing retraction by Mr. Holland. Other such stories that are not truthful retellings include the milk-stripping story told by Thomas S. Monson, the Charles Anthon-sealed book Revelation Fulfillment, the Sweetwater Rescue, and the false narrative that polygamy was instituted to care for widows. In a 2016 Young Single Adult Fireside, Jeffrey R. Holland claimed that the church was experiencing staggering growth, and that it was growing by double-digit stakes every week. He claimed that 15 stakes had been added in April. Both of these claims were brazen lies, per the church's own statistical records, which show growth of one stake per week and no stakes added in the month of April, when he reported double-digit growth. This is just one of many examples of lies told by LDS apostles to artificially inflate the faith of their followers. There is intense social pressure to do what the LDS Church says is your duty. Baptism, participation in temple ordinances, serving a mission, and marriage are all wrapped up in expectation and high social costs for failure. One horrible example of this toxic pressure to conform is the story of 18-year-old Caden Alibis, who was left in Bryce Canyon by his family when he expressed doubts about serving a mission. A mission that should have been his own personal choice became a necessity to avoid abandonment by his family. He was eventually able to call his grandfather, who rescued him from the desert, and dropped him off at the MTC so he could spend 2 years away from home, earning the conditional love of his parents. While the story represents an extreme, the expectation of conformity to earn conditional love is sadly not unique among members. The LDS Church puts a huge emphasis on obedience, teaching that obedience is the first law of heaven, making you swear obedience to the church in the temple, and suggesting that giving your will over to God via the church will result in blessings and salvation. However, obedience alone is not a virtue. There have been countless historical examples of obedience to higher authority, following orders, and doing your duty, leading to disgusting and immoral behavior. It has been repeated in several talks that obedience to prophets always results in blessings, even if the commanded action is immoral. This attitude of unquestioning obedience is incredibly dangerous, and has resulted in several documented tragedies in LDS history. A perfect example of unquestioning obedience to an immoral command comes from the Mountain Meadows Massacre. Following the murder of the Smith brothers, the LDS endowment was adapted to include an oath of vengeance, wherein LDS members vowed to avenge the blood of the prophets upon the United States. In fact, this oath is referenced in the LDS hymn, Praise to the Man, where W.W. Phelps demands that the earth, particularly Illinois, atone for the blood of that man. Parley P. Pratt also became a martyr by LDS standards when he was killed by the legal husband of one of his wives in Arkansas. When pioneers from Arkansas later entered Utah Territory, LDS members in Cedar City were ready to fulfill their oath of vengeance and do their duty. At the command of their state president, Isaac Haight, Mormon militiamen, poorly disguised as Paiute Indians, executed 120 innocent men, women, and children, sparing only the children believed too young to remember the slaughter. Brigham Young helped cover up the mass murder by blaming the Paiutes for the killings. The church has never apologized for this act or its role in demanding vengeance and bloodshed from its loyal members. LDS members often perceive persecution or malicious intent in innocuous situations. When Thomas Monson died, for example, members became positively outraged at the obituary written for their leader in the New York Times. There was nothing untrue or intentionally derogatory written about Monson or the LDS Church. It did, however, cover the facts that the church, under his leadership, rejected movements to ordain women, maintained its opposition to gay marriage, had to respond to the wide availability of church history in the information age, and saw a mass resignation. These were all newsworthy stories and events that had happened under his tenure, and belonged in a newspaper obituary of a public figure. Still, a scathing petition was widely circulated, gaining 190,000 supporters demanding an apology and a rewrite. A similar outrage campaign complained about Deadpool's parody of an LDS depiction of Jesus. For a faith that strives to be not of this world and to avoid seeking the praise of men, LDS members certainly give a lot of weight to outside opinion. BYU has a horrible track record when it comes to protecting its students from rape, only recently adopting an amnesty clause that allows victims to come forward without honor code repercussions. There is still a loophole in that clause where the bishop of the victim can revoke his endorsement, leading to expulsion for the victim. This is exactly what happened in August of 2018 at BYU Idaho, when a student was assaulted at a party while drunk and only partially conscious. She reported to the school and police while the man who assaulted her went to the bishop. While she couldn't be punished by the school for her use of alcohol, her bishop revoked his endorsement, which still resulted in her expulsion. Students at LDS universities will never be safe as long as rapists can hold expulsion over the heads of their victims to silence them. The LDS Church exerts an unhealthy and intrusive level of control onto its members, which even extends into the members' bedrooms. Members have been discouraged from using contraceptives and other forms of birth control, such as vasectomy or tubal ligation. The LDS handbook requires that a bishop be consulted before surgical sterilization is sought out, despite this being a completely personal matter that ought only to involve the couple. The church has also forbidden oral stimulation, which it considers an unholy and impure practice. When it comes to finances, the church requires members to covenant that they will give everything they own to the LDS church, and they are also required to meet once yearly with a bishop to ensure that they are paying enough tithing to keep their temple recommend. Members who don't pay a full tithe lose their recommend and access to the temple, and may miss important family events such as weddings and sealings. The church has also inserted itself into the delicate process of writing a will, suggesting, in a manipulative video, that the inheritance of apostate children be diverted instead to LDS philanthropies. One would expect these examples and numerous similar intrusions would be cause for outrage among members of the church. However, the church and the individual member have become so entwined that such obviously inappropriate intrusions are not perceived as such by the member.